Good evening.
Good evening,
everyone. I am so happy. I see so many familiar faces. Starting to feel like family. It's great. Welcome to all of the, I think it's fair to say, old timers, those that have been here for a few of these lectures. The newcomers, welcome as well. I hope everyone has signed in on the sheet in the back of the room. If you haven't, don't do it now, just do it on the way out. My name is Ron Christopher. I am the vice chair here at the Beach Institute. I am also the chair of the Cultural Affairs Committee. You are attending the Beach Institute Lecture and Learning Series. This is our fourth installment. So welcome, I'm happy to have you here. Today we are in for a treat. Let me start by thanking the City of Savannah, whose investment, both in terms of money, but in terms of moral support, makes events like this possible. We have a few representatives of the city here today, and I'm happy to see them. So thank you, Savannah. Our treat for today, I'm happy to say, is Ms. Patt, Gunn. Patt is a Gullah Geechee native from the soil of Savannah, Georgia, and is known throughout the Georgia coast as the memory keeper of African-American journey from slavery to freedom. She's a master storyteller, CEO of Underground Tours LLC, which is a cultural arts and heritage tour agency in Savannah. Operates also all along coastal Georgia and South Carolina. We are very happy to have her here today. She spits fire in her poetry and was honored to write a commissioned poem for the City of Savannah's inauguration entitled Savannah, A New Sunrise, that is registered in the city's municipal archives. Ms. Gunn is also the founder of Saltwater Players, a local folk artist group of Gullah Geechee freedom shouters, ring shouters, a cappella songs interwoven with stories, tambourines, scrub boards, and other percussion instruments that showcase historical reenactments. She mesmerizes audiences with her soul-stirring stories, slave narratives, African-American sheroes like Harriet Tubman and Ida B. Wells. Her work spans over 30 years. She's a graduate of Georgia State University with a BS in political science and postgraduate certifications as a paralegal specializing in criminal law. Ms. Gunn has performed in schools, churches, universities, and private parties throughout the nation. Her slave narratives and African-American sheroes programs have received accolades from audiences across the United States. In April 2015, she and the Saltwater Players traveled to Washington, D.C. for a two-week-long tour celebrating the 150th anniversary of the end of slavery, performing in the Rose Garden, at the White House, Ford's Theater, Lincoln Cottage, and the Lincoln Memorial. I should mention that she was also a co-founder and that she coordinated the premier National Slave Dwelling Project Conference in 2014 that was held in Savannah, Georgia. Her most recent project is the annual Jubilee Freedom Day celebration and art exhibit, The American Abolitionists, Conscience of the Nation, in December and February 2018 at the Georgia State Capitol. She's the proud mother of two college graduates, Imani and Ayana Gunn. Her famous Gullah Geechee quote is, "Who speak for we? We speak for we." Join me in welcoming Ms. Patt Gunn.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
Well, I really don't say good evening, you know. I say, how you be? And if you be fine, then the answer that you return is, we be fine. So, let's try it one more again. How you be?
We be fine.
How you be?
We be fine.
I think that's about a B plus, you know. Let's give it one more round. How you be, Savannah?
We be fine.
You got an A plus. I am so honored to be here tonight. A daughter of the dust of Savannah, Georgia. Long journey, you know, 60 years and tens. I am elated to say, as I go all over, you know, I am Gullah Geechee. Yes, who speak for we? We speak for we. The days of Gullah Geechee are not gone. No such a thing. Mama there, brother, uncle, sister, Titi, auntie, you know, we still here. We still know the clap. You just hold on, I'm gonna show you how to do it. We, as you say in the Gullah Geechee community, you and I, it's called Ona. So let me tell you something. If you make Ona mad, and you put a hand on the hip, you gotta stand back because you're getting ready to tell you a thing or two. We still eat rice 2 and 3 times a week to fill our palates, you know. We still sing calls. Songs, call and response. Common leader number 32. Amazing grace, how sweet the song that saved a wretch like me. We still do that on Sunday mornings in some of the small churches, you know, especially in West Savannah, the first settlement of enslaved Africans after emancipation and tea. Bear with my language, because this language that I'm speaking, you know, this is not Ebonics. I hear them turn, say, where you at? That's Ebonics. I am speaking a language, which is a Gullah Geechee language. And I think I got a little, you know, a housekeeping together. You see, Gullah Geechee is not a dialect. No such a thing. Gullah Geechee be a language, you know. And the dialect is interwoven into who we be. We are trying to preserve this culture. So call me a Gullah Geechee saltwater girl preservationist. I want to make sure that as we go all over the city of Tech and the coast of Georgia for sure, I want to make sure that when you pass Highway 17 going toward the Walmart area and you look to the left and the right, you'll see a lot of creeks in Tech. I want you to look down a little further in the creek and you're going to still see Mama them fishing in the creek. You're gonna still see on a Friday night a Sister Patt Friday night fish fry and tea. Sure, I'm talking about fried white tea, Savannah red rice, coleslaw, and I throw in a few hush puppies and tea. We still have a Friday night fish fry. And Friday is still a big fish market day. It's just we can't go down to the Savannah River because those big containers and big ships done took over the water. But we still celebrate. Why, just the other day, I went to the fish market, you know, and I said, every Friday, you know, I get 12 to 14 pounds of whiting. Now in Savannah, you can't have a fish fry with no kind of mullet. No way. You know, mullet got a little worm and taking it back. So you gotta have whiting. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Now, I didn't say tilapia. I said whiting. You have a fight about this thing in Savannah, you know. And so I went into the fish market, and I asked them for my 14 pounds of whiting, and the fish man tells me, he said, look here, I ain't got no whiting. All I got is some mullet. I said, what you say? He said, I ain't got no whiting. I say, with my hand on my hip and ting, I say, you know I come every Friday to get my whiting and stuff, and you don't have my whiting. Who you give it to, Miss Annie Mae around the corner, you sweet on her, huh? Well, all I can tell you, Look here, man, you better get back in the boat and get my whiting, because I got all them shrimp coming this evening for my fish fry. And lo and behold, he had my whiting wrapped up in a newspaper in a bag for Miss Annie and me. She got to find her another fish market, if you ask me. Folk ways and spirituality. I am so honored tonight to share stories as well as facts. History, you know, on the Gullah Geechee community. The Gullah Geechee Heritage Corridor was established by the National Park Service. It is called officially the National Gullah Geechee Heritage Corridor. It describes Gullah Geechee people as descendants of Central and West Africa, and they come from different ethnic groups. By way, of course, of the transatlantic slave trade, Gullah Geechee people were enslaved Africans isolated in Sea Island and barrier areas, which is now designated by the National Park Service as a stretch of corridor that starts from Ponder County, North Carolina, all the way down to St. Johns County, Florida, and 30 miles inland. That'd be Gullah Geechee. But we make it pretty plain. We say North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, and the northern end of Florida be Jacksonville and Tate. All them fancy words, you see. Gullah Geechee people, we try to consolidate the words. For example, we don't use the word TH too much. We don't say that, we say that. You know, like this and that. We have intonations in our words. So when someone says, really, we don't say really. We say, for true. But the intonations will tell you what's going on. So if somebody tells you something and you say, really? You have an intonation that goes up. Something very interesting is happening. The same thing for true. If something makes you feel bad and you say, really? Don't you say that sometimes? Well, Gullah Geechee do the same thing, you know. We say, for true. Intonations be Gullah Geechee. Sometimes mama them don't say but one word, but based on the intonations, you better watch out. For example, have you ever seen a Gullah Geechee woman in a grocery store when she tried to get her market done and she don't have enough money and the lady says it would be $27.17 and she say, $27.17? I ain't got no 17 cents. Child, I want you to let me have the 17 cents. $17. You say, 17 cents, ma'am, I need that. And a Gullah Geechee woman saying one word lets the cashier know what mood that woman is in. And that one word is, Can I get an amen on the hook? Gullah Geechee. If you say Gullah Geechee, from one of the languages of the tribes, the Mende, the Yoruba, the Geechee, the Yoruba houses on the northern end of northern Nigeria, you're speaking a tongue that came from us having to come here by way of the transatlantic slave trade and learn a different tongue. We have a tongue mixture. They call it British English in some places, you know. But we have a mixture. Like this is a bowl of potpourri and tea. We have a mixture of Portuguese. We have a mixture of Dutch. We have a mixture of English based on European travel. You put it all together and you got a Creole. And so the people in New Orleans say, they speak a little French patois. We say, we speak Gullah Geechee, and we mix a little French patois in there when we're in the right place. Now, if you're talking to a Gullah Geechee woman or a family member, and the family member is from Carolina, watch this now. I am Gullah on my father's side from Carolina, and my mom's side from Georgia. But the Gullah language is the language of the people. And Geechee is a dialect that comes out of Gullah Geechee. I repeat, Gullah is the language, and Geechee is the dialect that is like a cousin to Gullah Geechee. So therefore, it's interchangeable. Now, I hear some people say, well, the people from Carolina be Gullah because they on the side by the barrier and see islands. And the people on the Georgia side in Carolina in the division was the Ogeechee River, and that's why they be Geechee. I think not. Sound pretty good, though. There was a linguist by the name of Dr. Lorenzo Dow Turner. Born in Elizabethtown, North Carolina, Gullah himself, you know. And he was a professor at the University of South Carolina in the 1930s in the midst of the Depression. And he heard the students talking, and he heard the language. They were talking and cracking their teeth. And cracking the teeth in Gullah Geechee means a laugh. And he heard the laughter, and he heard the dialect. And instead of him saying, "What are you speaking? Why are you speaking this broken language?" he decided to study the language as a linguist. He attended Howard University with a bachelor's degree, you know, in English. And then he went on to Harvard and studied linguistics. And then he got a PhD in linguistics and English from the University of Chicago. He was headed to New Orleans, but that day in that classroom with those students from South Carolina, he decided to study the language of those students. He is the pioneer linguist that they are using today in the 21st century. He passed away in 1972. He is the father of linguistics for Gullah Geechee. And they're doing comparative analysis to this very day using Dr. Lorenzo Dow Turner's study, Gullah Geechee and the Africanisms. The book is a bestseller. You should pick up a copy if you want to study the language of Gullah Geechee people. Now, when it comes to Gullah Geechee folk, I did not know I was Gullah Geechee. I had a second grade teacher, and she said to me, "You must learn to speak well." And I learned to speak well. I learned, I mastered the English language. Fast forward, 1976, I come to Savannah. I get a contract to help black farmers. And I go to Liberty County, and I go to Glenn County, and all the rural counties, and even in Vidalia area. And I get lost one day, and I ask this young woman in Riceboro for directions. And she gave me the directions, but something peculiar happened in her mannerisms. She had her hand over her mouth giving me directions. I said, "Why are you talking to me with your hand over your mouth?" She said, "Because I'm ashamed of my tongue." "What do you mean you're ashamed of your tongue?" She said, "I speak a broken English." And I realized I was in Riceboro, Georgia, Liberty County, the county where rice was grown for the Confederate soldiers. During the Civil War, they were able to stop there and be fed. I realized that there are counties in Riceboro and Liberty County. The deeper you go into those communities, the thicker the dialect got. And I realized that I am in the middle of a Gullah Geechee community. I am in the area where Sherman and his Union soldiers disbursed 40 acres and a mule on Freedman Grove Road. The more I went into that community, the thicker the dialect. And so I now understand, you know, when you talk with someone that lives across the water in the Carolinas and they be pure, authentic Gullah Geechee, and you speak with someone that crosses the water in the urban communities of Savannah and Brunswick and Riceboro, we can interchange conversations for maybe about 10 minutes. And then all of a sudden, the dialect gets thicker and thicker. And I say, "Hold on, I ain't hear what you said now. What you say? What do you want me to do?" Because it's a flow and an intonation. If you're on a barrier island after the Civil War and post-emancipation, you kept your dialect, you kept your folk weight, you kept your food weight, and oh my God, you kept your spirituality. And so when people say, "Who are these Gullah Geechee people?" I say they are people that were blessed and guided by God Almighty to create a language among all of the tribes so that they could communicate with each other as they sit and preserve the things that were precious to them in terms of their tradition. We say on Sundays, in our supper time, in our grace, we say we're so thankful to God Almighty, and we say we are the ones that know what's going on around here. And we, the Gullah Geechee people, you know, must tell the story over and over again. Now, when it comes to the folk ways, I just want to share some things with you about the folk ways and ting, because it's important that you know that the folk ways, Gullah Geechee people, still exist.
On a back, on a menu, though, ask me for my recipe for sweet potato pie. I say, look here, I'm gonna give you this here recipe, but I don't want you to call and give my recipe to the Food Network. I want you to bake your yams. I don't want you to boil them. Because when you boil them, you lose a little flavor, amen? I know I got some cooks in here. I can see how y'all hold your hand. Well, I say you bake your yams. You put your butter, your milk, whatever you want to put in it, make it just so. And then I say you put some cinnamon and some nutmeg. And you stir it all up together or you lose your fancy mixer. Then my daughter, who is always interrupting me, you know, she said, Mom, why did you tell my friend to put cinnamon and nutmeg in a sweet potato pie? I say, child, I'm trying to teach them a Gullah Geechee food way. I say that when they bake a sweet potato pie and put it on the table coming out of the oven hot and tea, they're going to be so proud of themselves. But Lord of mercy, I feel so guilty, you know, because I was just remembering that I really didn't give them the recipe for sweet potato pie. I did not turn the recipe for sweet potato bread. Because that's a Gullah Geechee food way. You cannot get a recipe on the telephone from a Gullah Geechee man, of a cook, man or woman, you know. What you gotta do, if you like what you're tasting, you gotta go to their house. You gotta spend a little time in the kitchen with them. And they will show you by cooking. They're not gonna tell you. And Gullah Geechee folk, we don't use no kind of measurements. We are dash cooks. We put a dash of this and a dash of that because we cook based on survival. We cook based on what's in the cupboard, you know? So it doesn't matter whether I have some nutmeg or some cinnamon, I'm still gonna make that pie taste just good enough, you know? So I want the young people to understand that you need to get what Mima and Nana done for those recipes. Because if you don't do it, and she transitions on home, you're never gonna get the recipe for some lamb green rice. You're never gonna get the recipe for how to make the pound cake. You know how she used to do. She used to tell us, say, look here, don't slam that dough, because I got a cake in the oven, and if the cake falls, you're gonna fall. Now who remember that? You say, do you know that child is buying me to our house for dinner? And it tastes all right, but do you know they ain't had no kind of rice? I don't know what kind of household that is. Say, look here. This ain't got nothing to do with the gender or nothing. They say that the woman and the man should all both learn how to cook. Because when you get ready to give somebody the hand of marriage, in the South, at least, you know, you gotta give them a rice test. Now, this help. If they can't cook rice, don't you marry them. Because if they can't cook rice, they can't cook nothing. They can't cook nothing. But you gotta watch the dash cook. Because of the food ways, they're not gonna give you the recipe. They're gonna have on their aprons, and as they cook in the kitchen, especially something like maybe like devil crab or macaroni and cheese, or those things go in the wheel. They don't give the recipe. Or do. So they gotta get in the kitchen to help them, you know, wash dishes, do a little baby conversation, and you gotta wash that right hand apron, because that's where all of the seasonings be. So they're gonna be on TV telling you something, you know. But I trust you to know that you're and they will eat and enjoy any food way. But when the dinner, or the lunch, or even the breakfast or brunch is over, they're going to call for the chef. Can you ask the chef to come out of the kitchen? And I say to my auntie, auntie, please, now in their 20s and adults, do you know that they cannot call me on the phone? No such thing. And say, Mom, I'm getting married next May 2019 at 4 p.m. No such thing. Don't turn that come to Savannah, Georgia, with a young man and team, and they gotta come to a Gullah Geechee Soul Super Sunday meal. Can I get an amen? And when they come, everybody gonna be there. I'm talking about Ma and Pa, and Auntie and Nana and anybody else. Uncle George, all of them will be gathered and there. And if you're a vegetarian, we can work with that too, you know? But look here, we wanna ask everything, because this is a folk way, and I don't want you to miss it because we're still doing it. We say, what your name? Where you from? You got a job? Where you go to school? Where your mom name? Where your pa? Where your grandpa name? We gotta ask when we see our questions now, because we got a folk way that we still celebrate and practice. And this particular folk way is, you can't marry your first cousin. You can't marry your second cousin. You can marry your third cousin, but you better be careful. That's just a folk way, you know. Another Gullah Geechee folk way is, I remember last December, we had a celebration called Jubilee. We were celebrating the 21st of December, 1864, when Sherman and his Union troops came here. And the Jubilee happened when they were emancipated on that day in Savannah. Well, the mayor came to our celebration, and he said that he has never met anyone like one of them Gullah Geechee people, you know. He said they can be offended by someone today, and by tomorrow, we have forgiven them. And he said he didn't understand that. That's not a folk way. Now, that's a spirituality. Now, listen closely, because you will watch and learn how Gullah Geechee people be. So the Emmanuel Nine happened in Charleston, and Lord have mercy, I found myself talking back to the CNN News TV, you know. They say, what kind of people are these that 24 hours later, after someone has taken their loved ones away by gunfire, they forgive them? I'm telling the TV, tell them they're Gullah Geechee. Tell them they're Gullah Geechee. My daughter said, Mom, you're talking to the TV. I said, I know, but I want them to know those are Gullah Geechee people. Well, I must have talked to a lot of people that got on Facebook and things so much until the people from the National Public Radio, NPR, called me. They interviewed me, and I got a chance to have my say. So they said again, well, what kind of people are they? How can you forgive someone that has done such an atrocity in less than 24 hours? And I said, look here, I want you to know that based on our ancestors and what we endured during the transatlantic slave trade chain, you have to understand what we be. You see, when the pain is too hard, Lord have mercy, we are taught by Nana here to give it to God with quickness. So, when that happened in Charleston, the people gave that pain to God because it was too much to bear. Now, they didn't just like give it to God and say, oh well, we believe based on our spirituality and team, not based on any religion that is Europeanized. We just believe in our traditional spirit, all those different tribes we take. That pain that we have endured is too hard to bear. We have to give it to God with quickness. And so they gave that pain to God, you see. Now, they say, we have given the pain to God because some of them were some of my relatives. You say, we give the pain to God, you know, auntie and them. Not the younger generation, but we have to get to the young folks quickly when something happens. And we say, we give it to God. It's too much pain to carry, we give it to him, this is his universe. But we know that if we give it to God and he carry it, we know that he will allow us to live long enough to see the atrocity reap what it sows. I think some of y'all young folks call it karma. Too much pain. Spirituality. When you're in a church and there's an elder there, the same respect that I saw in West Africa, I see in Gunn community to this very day. They say in West Africa, when I was in Ghana, I wanted to go from Ghana to Senegal. And I had an airline ticket that had to be changed. They say you must go to the airport, you must go early and change your ticket. And I did. They said, oh, by the way, you forgot to tell Una. They say, if an elder comes, you have to move back in the line. I said, how do I know it's an elder? I see some of these ladies and they don't have any wrinkles. Say, you would know the elders by the head wrap, because an elder's head wrap is high. And she has lots of jewelry because she has lived a long life. Well, lo and behold, I'm in there, and here comes an elder. I politely move back. And Lord have mercy, there come another elder, and another elder, and another elder. I said, I'm never going to get to Senegal. And someone heard my southern drawl. And they said, where are you from? And I really put it on. I said, Savannah, Georgia. And they said, oh, you're traveling from America. They went to the front and announced, there's an American woman traveling, let her through. So they let me through the elders. I felt like the parting of the Red Sea. That is a privilege, that is an honor, because you have to honor the elders. Most times, before we speak, we ask permission in our churches when they are elders. If there are any elders here, yes, then we ask the elder for permission to speak. That's how much pride we have based on how we were taught in our churches. So the elders in American churches in the South still practice our respect for the elders, the community, loves and adores the mothers of the church. The mothers in the church are the ones that keep the memory for us, you know. She wants us to remember that when you was in a slave plantation, you ain't had no church. You see, you had a bush farm, and Lord of mercy, you had to go in the bush and path, clear the pathway. You had to take a bucket of water, and you had to put it there. And when you got ready to pray, you had to pray in the water so the master won't hear the sounds. That was a bush farm. Then, you got emancipation and tape, and you got a praise house. And you got a praise house now where you had church, and you had school. And Lord of mercy, let me tell you about the praise houses. We only have two praise houses left in the state of Georgia. I went over to Carolina, you know, and the Fusty Island, y'all remember Captain Sam and the Fusty Island, and take a raise your hand. Well, remember all that plum wine thing, I went over there, they had a new church they built, and they were celebrating. But the old church was demolished. By the time I got there, the only thing left was a tin roof on the praise house on the ground. I picked it up and went over to some ladies. I said, this is not preservation. The brand new church is wonderful, but we have to preserve the old. They did not know. We began to do preservation work on the Fusty Island. We are the ones that know the going on around there. On the tidy side, evil landed. The evils were a Yoruba tribe, you know, crossing over. Royalty, they say. Legend or truth? They say that the royalty of the evils on the slave ship, when it come around Lazarus Creek, there was a quarantine hospital there. And they say there is where they did an inventory. If you was a sick slave, you would be thrown into the water of the Lazarus Creek area. You hear the old saying, you're up the creek now? They come from Lazarus Creek. They say the quarantine hospital divided the young and the old and the skilled ones. And they say when they come around the Savannah side, the evils that was on that slave ship say, we be royalty and we shall not be enslaved. And the legend of evil landing says, as they went from Savannah to St. Simon's Island, they said those royal Africans made a 360-degree turn as they exited the boats, the ships, you know. And they say that those eagles fly away. They say the eagles walk back to Africa. Real or make believe? We do not know. But if you go to St. Simon's, you will see markings on the oak trees that the eagle landing soldiers, the royal troops left. You will see a floating cemetery. Eagle Landing still exists. We must preserve those safe spaces. Safe spaces should be turned into sacred places and spaces where our ancestors dwelled. If you walk around Savannah, and you walk around River Street, and you go a little further up into the bottom area of Factory Walk, and you look down there at the Klusky embankment, the city says, we cannot verify that there was not a slaveholding den here. We will not refute it, but we just don't have any evidence. Well, if you Google Ghana slave castles, you will see the exact image of those slave castles that look just like the Klusky embankments. I wish there could be a DNA of that entire four speckled building. You will find Ibu, Balani, Mandinka, Didi, Ibu, from the Ibu landing, the royalty of the people, they left their marks. If you go a little further up to the Savannah Cotton Exchange, you will see Ibu landing markings and a deeper markings on the Savannah Exchange wording. Klusky was an architect that built the Klusky Embankment, and he also built the Savannah Cotton Exchange. Beautiful burnt orange terracotta building. But if you look at the wrought iron, and I challenge you to do so, just below the Cotton Exchange, and you Google the Adinkra symbols, and you walk with those symbols in your phone, Lord have mercy, you shall see the Adinkra symbols all around the ironworks of the Savannah Cotton Exchange. The one particular one that sits right in front of the Savannah Cotton Exchange has a circle in the front of it, and then little signs signaling. That is an Adinkra sign for freedom and emancipation. It's as if the Gullah Geechee enslaved people decided that we're gonna leave our mark. You know the history, well, I gotta make my mark and dash in the middle of a ticket. Well, I say to you, Savannah, that the Gullah Geechee symbols by way of those tribes are all over Savannah. When the U.S. Senate does their opening arguments, if you look just above their head, you will see a deep of symbols. They're at City Hall, they're at the U.S. Customs Office, they're all over the squares and the fancy plantation owners' homes. We are the ones that know the going on around there. We are the ones that must tell a story. Now, when it comes to the folkways, Gullah Geechee people are clear that we are in the 21st century. So, we are not advising our children, you know, our children, young folk. We are not advising them to go on a job interview and speaking the Gullah language. We want them to speak the English language properly. But when you get around family and friends, we want you to relax your tongue. Wherever you're from, you should speak your language. So, I have a story about a food way. Look here. Some of the students that attended school in Atlanta with one of my daughters, they were from California, and they did not have enough airfare to travel back on some of those holidays. So, come Thanksgiving and Christmas, I said, bring them to Savannah. And we would have the traditional foods, you know? And they love this Geechee girl, sweet potato pie. My house, and I serve everybody, and everybody that comes wants a recipe. So, watch for the dash cooks in your families. They cook by their own hands, and they say to you, it's all in the wrist. And if it tastes real good, guess what they say?
Ooh, child, I went over to Sister Rod's house, and she had some peas and rice. She don't have a dollar to take. And I tell you one thing, she sure put her foot in that thing. We get that all the time. Well, I have a surprise person that is here, and she is a slavery and actor. She also is a part of our group that does folk art. She is Roz Rouse, a local girl from Savannah. And Sister Roz, I just want to know what the people say, what the people say. Now listen here, I don't know if these young folk in this room is old enough. I see a couple of people look gray and pink. Come on here, Mrs. Roz. So look down. You see, here's the thing I want you to know. I had to take the Milton cab the other day.
What do people say?
Milton cab. AD 624-24. The number, you know
what? What'd you say that now?
I called the cab, and the cab come. And do you know they had 5 people in the cab? That's how you do.
No such a thing.
No, no. They used to get the Uber and all that right now. We had to take a taxi cab, and it had 6 people in it sometimes.
That's right.
And it depends on what part of the city you're going to. You just have to wait. If you get in the Milton cab on the east side and you're going to the west side, you might have to wait a while because somebody else wants to close their office some mess.
That's right.
And then when I was trying to call the cab system, you know we had a party line.
Party line, yeah, party line.
I couldn't get the cab because Miss Anime down the street was on the phone talking so much stuff.
She was getting them board leaders in.
Well, I tell you one thing, I had to go to work and she was saying no. Ooh, I'm kind of taking that.
That party line, she was on that party line.
Well, the operator said it was an emergency. Mm-hmm. I gave up the number and the phone and everything for her. And when I gave it up, she asked me about how much was the peaches per pound yesterday.
What?
I said, she asked how much the peaches were. And the person on the other side said, the peaches were $2.49.
What you say?
Well, I remember Mama done used to send me to the lady next door house. Asking me to ask her how much was the peaches per pound.
Complete on both leaders.
I said, I look over and they tell me the price and I look back and tell Mom. Mm-hmm. Well, guess what?
What she say?
I didn't know till I got to be a grown person that I was numbers wrong. Four ways.
That's right.
Now, Sister Rod, what people say?
Well, the people say the party line. If it was busy, you could sometime hear Sister Susie trying to figure out who stole the chicken dinner money.
Oh, Lord.
First she said it was the preacher. Now that's what the people had said. That's what they had said. But they tell me. That's what they tell me now. The party line. See, I couldn't get through now.
Okay.
But Miss Annie May
said
the deacon stole the chicken dinner money. Now that's what the people had said. That's what they told me now.
I don't know. When I was in the cab, they said it wasn't the deacon, wasn't the preacher, wasn't none of that. It was the sisters on the usher, too. So, we got to pay attention to that.
That's right. That's right.
When I put my money in the plate, I want my money to go for the service and the Lord. I don't want it to go to somebody else.
No such a thing. No.
So, I was just wondering, what other kind of folk ways do you think? You know? I know some people in our community to this year's date. This right here, 2018, right?
What do people say?
There's some people in the community. The people say now. I didn't say
that. That's what the people say now.
Don't say it because I'm just telling you what the people say.
The people say.
The people say the people read the newspaper and they look to see who died. They don't know. They go to the funeral and then they go to the repast.
That's right.
And see all the people who.
I went to the repast. I looked for the greens. All I saw was the pot.
Oh, God, I'm falling. Well, at least for the pot, they can use a dip a little more drink.
That's right. That's right. If you get it for the deacon,
you got to get them 2 helpings.
Oh, yes.
That's the fourth way.
I'm going to take a plate home now.
No, the preacher eats first, then the deacon, then the trustees board.
And the mother board.
Then the mother board.
Then the usher board. Then the junior choir.
I didn't get no food.
I got to pack your lunch.
Fourth way is speciality. I remember, this is a true story, you know. My great-great-grandma, her name was Princess Golden from the Golden family.
I can't tell her.
Well, she was a good cook, you know. They say she was working a big house in Tate. They say that maybe like 3 days before the 21st of December,
yep,
back
shrie,
in the
1864,
she was serving in the Tate. and they was talking about how the slaves was gonna be freed.
Ooh.
And so they said, my great grandma, true story, sister, said she went back down to the slave quarters and she knocked on the door. Said, what you want? Said, the sword is coming. We're gonna be free in 3 days. I'm leaving tonight. They say, sister, don't leave tonight. You want to leave when day clean. Day clean, you know me, and sunrise. Said, nope. I done been around enough politicians to know that they said we're gonna be emancipated, and the politicians was at the table. I was serving them all, the generals and everything.
That's right.
But they might change their mind come sunrise, so I'm leaving tonight.
So
they went on down the road. Everybody was following her. They say, have you seen my sister? Have you seen my brother? Have you seen my baby? Anybody seen her?
No.
Say, from now on, the garden will tell you the name of the gold. And they're going to boil that for everybody to be family.
That's right.
But see, that's why you got that folkway about the first and second cousins.
That's right.
Because you know the garden, I see them some down, time down there and live in the county. And they don't know their cousins with the gold. So you know they're the first cousins and the second cousins. All mixed up now. All mixed up.
Mixed up.
You sure better find out who your people be.
That's right.
You sure better find out. Now, if you talk about turn of the century and take, in terms of Gullah Geechee people, in terms of the folk ways and the memories, you know. And he said, look here, I like your garden. How did you get this garden to grow like this? He said, I got a horse, and the horse is plowing. None of that. Well, I said, you should go down the road, the lady said, and get your horse and let the horse plow your field. So, this was 1879. I live by myself on my land.
That's right.
And I said, I'm going to go with the man down the road. So we went down the road with the man so he could buy him a horse. So we went down the road and they say, Mr. John is the one that got all the good horses.
That's right.
See? Well, I want to buy me a good horse. So he knocked on Mr. John's door. He said, what do you want? He said, I want to buy a horse. He said, well, what kind of horse? He said, a horse that can plow the field. I'm very busy. Just pick out any of the horses in the field. All of them are good horses. Well, the man picked out a horse. Sister, that horse was brown with a brown fluffy tail. Remember that?
Yes, sir.
Well, he picked out the brown horse with a fluffy tail and teeth. And Lord of mercy, he tell the horse, when he get on it, he say, giddy up, horse. The horse saying, ooh. He said, giddy up, horse. That horse still ain't moving.
Still ain't moving.
Well, we went down the road and the man said, this man done sold owner a horse and the horse don't move. What do you think I should do, sister? I live by myself and every now and then, you know I like a little education.
Yes, sir.
So I told the man, if it was owner, I would go back down the road and give all my money back. He said, you think so, girl? You think so? I said, I think so. So we went back down the road to Mr. John's house one more game. And we knocked on the door. Say, what you want? I put my hand on my hip like I do when I gotta tell you, I take a look. And I say, look here, like I said before,
wait a second.
I ain't got no business with you, you know. But that man, they say, you done sold a bad horse.
That's right.
And he say, want all the money back. He say, you want the money back? And I said, what you want all the money back? He said, I can't get a man the money back because I don't spend the money on something else. So, well, I don't know that between you and that man, you know. But you better get a man the money back. He said, well, which one of the horses did he pick? I said, you told the man that all the horses was good horses. So the man picked out a horse with a pretty brown, fluffy tail. Said, oh God, he done pick out the wrong horse. I said, what you mean? You're the wrong horse, sister. He told the man, all the horses were good. Well, he said, that horse that he picked out, Lord have mercy, that brown horse with a fluffy tail. Yeah. He said, that's a special horse. I say,
what
do you mean? He said, special horse.
What do you mean?
I say, what kind of horse is this? He said, that horse you pick out, that's a religious horse.
A what?
A religious horse.
A religious horse?
I say, what kind of horse? He says, a religious horse. Well, I know for a fact, sister, I ain't never seen no horse go to check for me.
Oh, no, sir.
No,
ain't going to no check. Ain't going to no check.
No, sir.
No, no.
So I want to know how this horse be religious, you know? He said, look here, go tell that man. His name was Mr. Henry.
Yeah, Mr. Henry.
And you know he don't want to church at all.
No church.
He attend his time, but he won't go.
He ain't going to church.
He said he not religious. He said he's spiritual. So he set a tie for the deacon of it. Well, he said, well, tell that man, say, if he wants that horse to move, he got to say, praise the Lord. If he wants the horse to stop, he got to say, hallelujah. The man said, I'm a fellow horse, praise the Lord. And when the man said, praise the Lord, he was on the horse and all, that horse got to move. He said, well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And he was moving and moving and moving and moving, and the horse was going faster and faster. And he was praising the Lord, praising the Lord, praising the Lord. And he didn't see the girl coming, and he was praising the Lord. So he was praising the Lord. And all of a sudden, the girl was getting faster to him. He said, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And next thing you know, the girl come up. He said, hallelujah. And that horse, show that man.
Praise the Lord. People say,
there's a moral to every story. Mm-hmm. People say that man needs to learn something about folk ways of the Gunn people.
That's right.
Because the Gunn people believe that no matter where you go in the world, Gunn people believe that you must never ever be so high and mighty, you know, that you forget to praise your higher power. Mm. Hallelujah! 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 Now, I know we got some Q&A, but I just want to know that you feel the spirit. Are y'all feeling the spirit?
Yeah.
Well, there's a song that I want to teach you before we do Q&A. It's about Sister Molly. And all you got to do is become your own drum. You know, you can take your hand, and your hand are now a drum. And so you got a little beat like this. Right? Let's go. Bring me little water, Molly. Woo! Bring me little water now. Bring me little water, Molly. Fast as you can. Molly, come running.
Woo!
I need a hand.
Yeah!
I will bring you water. Fast as you can. Bring it in a bowl. Yes, ma'am. What's your name?
Is there a Gullah Geechee University is now teaching Color DT 101. We would love to have it here.
Yes.
Maybe we could have it at the Beach Institute. It's a folk way language that if we don't preserve it, we're gonna lose it. If we talk about elders and the elders in the Gullah Geechee community being in their 80s, what we know for sure is that when an elder dies, we lose a library. So we must hurry. We must hurry and teach other folks this language so that they can enjoy it. It's a wonderful language.
Hey, I just want to say it's fabulous.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. I just heard you.
I just want to say that my grandmother, my family's from Tuskegee Island, and we spent summers on the island.
Yeah.
And I just want to say that you just brought back to me so many fond memories.
Yeah.
I can see my grandmother, she's so Democrats at Beautiful Pride.
Yeah.
You know, she
just
brought all that back to me. I just want to say thank you for that.
Well, you know, I appreciate that, but what I want you guys to know is that through our organization, we can recreate those things. We take people on water tours. I don't know if you know Mike Neal, but we go out on water tours. We have put together Gullah Geechee Sunrise, Sunset Tours. So if you're creative, call us and we'll make it happen. We've done intercultural tours where we take them by waterway and show them the different places where Gullah Geechee people dwell. I would love to take a group over to the Fuss. They're our friends. They will be welcome them to come over. Yes.
That's me. My name is Valerie too. I was just wondering, like, in Savannah, I know they have like they had several pockets of communities here that were Gullah Geechee, like Tatumville, Young Crow, something like that. I was just wondering, do you know which one of those communities that you originated from, or some of your kin originated from in Savannah?
I was born on the east side, and my brother is here, and I want to acknowledge him. Representative Carl Hilliard in the back. Kudos to him. It's typical if you were born on the east side. Now, if you're from Savannah, you know there's an east side, and there's a cross the track side. Amen? So we're on the east side. So we weren't allowed to go past a certain area without your parents' permission. But one of the areas that I know that is no longer in existence but really needs to be preserved in terms of the people who are from there is Frogtown. And you know Frogtown is right down in El Cain where Mark is. All of that community back there is Frogtown. There are still a couple of churches back there. I would challenge young people to do some oral traditions and go and record them because they lived in that Gullah Geechee community, Taylorville, Frogtown. Oh my goodness, there are all kinds of pockets of Gullah Geechee.
And I work at the Pinpoint Heritage Museum.
Of course, Pinpoint, yeah. But what I want people to understand is that all of Savannah is Gullah Geechee.
Mm-hmm.
All of Savannah. Now, just to be sure to be clear, Gullah Geechee is a language, but it's based on culture. And what I found over the years is that Gullah Geechee is not based on the hue. Now watch this. I said Gullah Geechee is not based on the hue. The reason for that is no matter where you live, if you live in a community, you took on those traditions. So I had a friend down in Brunswick, St. Simon's area, in fact, and she had the prettiest blonde hair and blue eyes, a light baby blue convertible, and we did a lot of writing during festivals. We got these folks to pass the bill to give us a festival, and we're hanging out, and she calls me one day and she says, Patt, why don't you come to St. Simon's, just forget about Savannah for the day and drive down. And you can get in that BMW, and we can just hang out. Well, when I got there, and I got to her house, I smelled the aroma, Raj, gumbo.
Yes,
and I said, where did you learn? She said, I was born right here, and I learned to cook it from my next door neighbor, who was Gullah Geechee. So everything I cook has gumbos and fillets and all of that. So then I realized that Gullah Geechee or whatever culture you have is based on the heart and not the hue. So the only thing I want to correct her on is that she said that I should come to St. Simon's and get in her blue convertible BMW, and we should let our hair blow. And I said to her, I'll get in your car with you, but my hair doesn't blow. Three port of entries for slavery in the nation, Savannah, Charleston, and then Virginia. So no matter where they went from this point, they came here first, the quarantine hospital, Lazarette Creek, then they came around to the Savannah River area, and the rest is history in terms of the slavery, the Negro slave auctions and all, but they came here first. Savannah was oh, she's first. You go ahead, since you're up first.
Is there a regularly scheduled tour which you leave to Defeski?
No, those will be special tours that we could set up, and we'll be glad to do that for you. The regular tours that we have are underground tours. We have them every day with the exception of Monday, and then 10 o'clock, 1 o'clock, and 3 o'clock down the river right in front of the African American Monument. We do tours, and our most popular tour is called Slaves in the City. We also have a Friday night fish fry dinner theater that we do. We also are getting ready to go to Sapelo Island for a day trip. You can go to Butler Island and see the plantation there. We also are going over to the Gullah Festival. So we put together a lot of day trips. If you see something you want, you call Underground Tours and we'll make it happen. We'll even put together a personal dinner. We can bring dash cooks to your house. We can fix the dinner for you and disappear if you tell them you did. Also a wonderful cook, and we're going to get to your house soon, because you're going to cook for us, right, Luke? Yes.
You have a brochure on the tours?
Yes, we do. You can pull up our website, Underground Tours, of Savannah.net, and it's there. I also, this lady here, she has a question.
So the term
Nana
came from?
That's a Gullah Geechee word for grandma. Yes, that's the original word from the, I've gone to Ghana, Abidjan, which is the Ivory Coast, Senegal, Gori Island, and I heard all four countries say Nana.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, let me just say this about the food. I went to a luncheon in Abidjan, Ivory Coast, and they said, make sure to order the jollof rice, and I said, okay. And every time I would order, they would run out, so I went early, and I ordered jollof rice, and I had my own personal fork and everything. And the rice was the same rice we have in Savannah, red rice. So again, same difference. They also had a bush meat stew, and I asked them what was the bush meat, and they said they didn't know. So I went back to my trail mix.
And I don't want to stop the flow of Q&A, if you're not a member, become a member. Go to our website, sign up, speak to somebody here, sign up and become a member.
I'm going to be able to see this. We must preserve our
museum,
and this is a sacred place, and I get an amen.
Amen.
So we join the French and Pope Francis, we have to serve this wonderful institution. We're just honored to be here. This institution is a sacred place so much to us. Listen. We've gone to the National Monument, African American Museum in D.C. We've gone to the Lincoln Monument and stood at the same exact spot that Dr. King did his I Have a Dream in Marketplace. We went to the White House, we went to the Lincoln Cottage, all of those places, but nothing is more sacred than your own home place. And did you know that the state representative reminded me the other day that the museums in Savannah, the Beach Institute, as well as the Civil Rights Museum, are state treasures. People come here from all over and we need to show them what we have inside of our museum. And so we must pledge to do better by these museums. we went to the White House, and they gave us a notice in 2015, I believe, when they invite us to the White House. This is what they do. This is a quick story. They invite us to the White House for April 2015, but they told us in December of 2014. And they said you can't tell anyone because you're still getting vetted. So how do you tell a Gullah Geechee person that you got invited to the White House from December to April and keeping a secret? So I didn't tell anyone we were going to the White House, but everywhere I went, I told them we're going to this big house in Washington that's white. So when we got there, we were celebrating the 150th anniversary of the end of slavery and the assassination of Abraham Lincoln 150 years later. We were in the Emancipation Parade like they did the Glory movie. But the thing that was most important to me, and this is a hard story, the thing that was most important to me is the President of the United States at the time was President Obama, his wife, the kids, Mrs. Robinson, and some of the cousins were there. In the receiving line, and they give you the instructions, don't take napkins, don't take plates, don't take anything, don't be like Barbara Rose. I wasn't even gonna take anything of collectible, I was there. The bottom line though is, as we're going through the receiving line, our group, the President of the United States said, are you that group from Savannah, Georgia? We said, yes. And he said something that is just off my bucket list, I have to start my bucket list. He said, I knew you were here when you entered the gates because we can feel your spirits. Wow. The thing is, I'm always looking, and you should too, I'm always looking for some Gullah Geechee in everybody, no matter if you're in Washington or Oregon, I'm looking for some Gullah Geechee, right? So I say, this is very nice, a rose garden, all of that is nice, but I sure wish I could see the White House kitchen. And then I get a tap on my right shoulder, real firm. And then I had a flashback to the 1960s when I was like, you know, in the revolutionary movement, and I thought they're coming again. They say they're going downstairs to the kitchen with Mrs. Robinson. So I go downstairs with Mrs. Robinson, First Lady's mother, and she says, this is the White House kitchen. I said, oh, this is nice. Now they tell me you have your own apartment, because I did my homework, you know. And I said, so you can order what you want, or you can prepare your own. She said, yeah. I said, I'm looking for Gullah Geechee now. I said, so what do? You just order and they bring it? She said, yes. I said, well, you're from Chicago, but by way of North Carolina, which is Gullah Geechee. So what do you do when you really want some down-home food? She said, come this way. We went over the same area of the kitchen. We opened a cabinet and it looked like a little blind sushi going round and round. And she showed me a black cast iron frying pan. Turn some more, and there's the Dutch oven, you know, with the handles. I said, Mrs. Robinson, you're Gullah Geechee. And I can go back to Savannah, Georgia now because I found in the White House some Gullah Geechee for. So I'm always going to go. Just a little tension, though, just a little tension. Yes,
ma'am. Can you give us some details about the Friday night fish fry?
Oh, surprise. Now, this is the Friday night fish fry master chef. She does all the fried whiting. And it's a dinner theater.
Where?
At the Civil Rights Museum. The next one is May the 25th at 6 p.m. It's going to be held on the grounds of the Civil Rights, Ralph Martin Gilbert Civil Rights Museum. And it will have Friday night fish fry foodways as well as performance by the Saltwater Playwright. It's called the Savannah Friday Night Fish Fry. And what we realized is that there are fish fries all over the nation. So why not Savannah? We'll get all our local fish. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to go for real, we'll get our fish, and we'll get it from
Saltwater.
Yes, it's an event page now on Facebook. If you look on Facebook, it's Savannah Friday Night Fish Fry. I have the time for it.
Yeah, tell them to stay tuned for that time. We'll get
it. It's only at 6 o'clock.
Okay, this is it. Okay.
Yeah, people come and try it, but that's fish
fry. Okay. People say that.
Yes, the fish fry is $25 per person, and it's all you can eat. It's like I said, it's fried whiting, and red rice, coleslaw, hush puppies, and low country boil. And the dessert is key lime pie. At 6 p.m.
I don't want it all to be gone.
also that sang for us and performed as part of our tour. You'll see him in Johnson Square. So I wanted him to also come, and I want to acknowledge him as one of our performers as well. Are there any more questions? The UT is going to close us out with a wonderful song that we all know. Yes. When is someone going to write a book? I mean, she said, when is someone going to write a book? I am writing a book, but I got to get away. I got to get a place where there's no phones. I want to finish. I'm writing a book called Hope Ways to Win. I promise you I'm going to put it out to finish by the end of the year. Also, please allow me also to introduce Ann Soulsby. She's a powerful person, one of the best in the city. Also, I have a couple of surprise people that I'm honored that are here that came, and they always supported me, and I see them in the audience. I just want to acknowledge them. Valerie Dunham, she's here, and she's a wonderful supporter of Bella Gucci. I see my friend, my sister friend, and professor, Dr. Faye Park from Georgia Southern is here.
And on our sign-in sheet in the back, please do so before you leave. You should have also picked up an evaluation form, which is very important to us. We want to know what you think. So please, if you don't have the form, there are many on the back table. Pick one up. There are pens and pencils back there. Fill it out. If we don't have your contact information in-house, and you should know that whether we do or not, please include your contact information on that form as well. Right? And we'll be in contact with you about future lectures. Now, the Beach Institute Lecture and Learning Series hosts a lecture here the fourth Wednesday of every month. So bear that in mind. If you provided us with your contact information, we'll make sure that you're notified in advance of each of those events. We have some refreshments in the room to my right. At the end of this, you know, feel free to go in there and refresh yourself, mingle, you know, talk. And so at this point, I'm going to hand it off to Mr. James Frazier,
yes,
who can close it out for us.